now we will move from Asia to Europe. And so I would like to invite Wolfram Horseman to come. Wolfram is the scientific director of the Open Air Project. Scientific coordinator of the Open Air Project and the director of the University of Michigan Library. So thank you, Wolfram.
Thank you. Yeah, hello once more from my part. I'm giving a brief update on the European situation. It starts with open air because this is one of the hats I wear, but I will also try to give a little bit an overview of what else is going on in Europe, because I think that some of you come here from far away and probably like to know what is the current situation, what is the context. I would like to spend some minutes in the end on that, but I will start with the things that we are all very familiar with, namely the repository infrastructure. We have this large project, Open Air, that is running since many years now, 2005 roughly, if you count Driver, so over 10 years. And yay, we want to build a legal entity this year, so we're hoping that we will also be supported by the European Commission with operational funding for the legal entity, because we think that the work that we're doing is actually a sustainable thing. It's not only dependent on project money. It doesn't mean that we don't want to have projects in the future. We will have projects in the future, actually just have a new proposal in the pipeline. But we would like to establish an office that is doing open access policy work in Europe on a regular and permanent basis. And that is basically what we're doing. We're implementing open science policy of the European Commission, also helping to spread the word in the individual countries. And we're doing that mainly by two parts of the infrastructure. So I'm starting very simply, trying to, because I don't know whether everybody has heard about it. So our approach is that we have two parts, a human network and the infrastructure. And sometimes it is, infrastructure is confused with only some kind of technology. That's what we learned over the years, that this is not actually working. We need the human network to spread the word in the individual countries, and we have a system of national open access desks established for that, that I will introduce in a second. This is basically what I just said. And then we have the technical infrastructure, and there we're doing what we already heard several examples from other regions and areas and countries. We're harvesting the metadata that are available from the repositories and enriching them with information that maybe the repositories themselves don't have to provide added value services, which I'm also going to explain in a little bit more detail. We have around 50 partners. It's a very, very large project. You can imagine that the administration of this project, because these are formal partners who receive project money, is quite high. But it's working, and it's worth it, and it's appreciated by the politics, by the European Commission, because we actually get things done in terms of implementing the policy. So here you see that we have every European country covered, even only geographically, not geopolitically European countries, or some of the countries are actually part of the European Union, but anyway they are represented. And the way it works, for those who don't know it, I know that some of the national coordinators are actually here. We have national contact points in every country, because we also have this language problem that we have to translate the policy that is issued by the Commission into the individual countries, and then we have the contextual, the political translation work that needs to be done. So you can imagine that you have the European general policy, and then you have the individual country levels that are having other policies. There are, of course, funding programs, not only in the European Commission, but in every country there are national funding schemes. They have their national open access policies. There sometimes are differences between the policy of the European Commission and the policy of the individual funder, and all this work has to be translated. And these guys, many of them are organizing the, for example, the open access days, trying to get in touch with the funders, spread the word in the country through roadshows and so on. So this is the human part of the network that I was mentioning. And of course we're having worldwide synergies through CORE. We continue, I mean CORE is actually the formal partner in the project, because I have no specific slides on CORE. I should mention that at this point. CORE is a partner, a formal partner of OpenAir, and the original idea was actually that CORE is helping to make what is European, multinational but European, a global initiative. So we had several activities, some figures here. You see that the approach is a little bit administrative, because we're very much focused on the funding of the European Commission. So the PIs on the projects to make it very concrete, and to help the PIs on the projects fulfill, comply with the policies of the European Commission regarding open access, which is of course in general put things on repositories or publish in Go journals, if you want to put it that way. So there were over 20,000 contacts, individual contacts being organized so far. Also, there is a network of over 1,500 repositories that are in contact with the help desks and with the national access desks. We are also working with publishers to get policy compliance help from them, because some of the data that we need to check whether a given project is actually complying with European policies are coming from publishers. So we are trying to work with them to also to make it easier for the individual project or the individual PI to comply with the policy. And we're engaging also in policy making. We have certainly an agenda also here to influence the policy. So we're not only implementing the policy of the European Commission, but we're also informing the policy, for example, through assessments and evaluations of how the open access is being implemented in Europe. And from the technical perspective, we have the repository landscape. You're all very familiar with this. I don't have to explain that again, I think, but maybe it is important because it was not mentioned expressly so far, that we are looking at journals, as I mentioned, but also looking at CRIS systems. And we have CRIS systems, our current research information system, where research intelligence is being held and processed and managed. And this university system also has important information that we need, for example, about organizational affiliations within the university. We can do author disambiguation through these systems, and we can relate the individual publication to, for example, a project that the publication has been produced by. And what is shown here that I didn't mention so far, because we're not only working with publications but also extending towards data, as all the others are doing as well. We heard already about it. We have Zenodo, the fallback repository for people that do research data publishing in a way and don't have any other possibility. And that was also built by OpenAir, I think. is also used worldwide in the meantime, but it's a kind of spin-off side result of over there. And we're taking all this data, the laser is a little weak, but we're taking all this data and clean and validate, duplicate, you know, the guidelines, so on, and try to build a European current research information data set on top of that for each publication, not only having the general bibliographic data there, but also having funding information on the data, which part of the organization it's coming from, what is the project the publication is stemming from, and what related data or software is there available with regards to this, to an individual different publication. And through this enrichment process that happens at the aggregation stage, we can actually deliver several added value services to several target groups. And three classes of target groups are identified here: the funders, the research administrators, the research communities themselves, the content providers, and the researchers. And you see basically the service portfolio that can be built on that. So this is quite an interesting approach to take the data, but not only provide a search interface on the data, because this also is done very well by Google Scholar, for example. Most of our researchers are using Google Scholar. And so this is not, it's also one added value. And we need to have the search engines for open access, the specific search engines for open access as well. We cannot rely on Google Scholar only in the long run, so we need base. Search engines, but we also need to develop added value services that actually make a difference to the other services that are provided and help not only the Commission implementing their policy, but eventually helping the researcher to make the life easier. So the idea here is, for example, if you have a European project and you have to do a report in the end of the project on your publications, you can just pull the data from website and put them in your report. In an optimal case, you wouldn't even have to pull the data from the open air website. Your publication is, for example, but you can just refer to a service. That's the optimal case we would like to arrive at with the European Commission. The European Commission simply says so. Just look at the open air site. Everything should be there. That's what we're working towards. We're not yet there, but we're trying to. There are several services we're currently working on and releasing them and further developing them, as I said at the beginning. We have one proposal in the pipeline at the moment, which is under review. We're hopeful that we will be funded for several more years, and other than that, we're hopeful that we can build a legal entity to establish the office. To give a little more background, as promised, on what is going on in general, I picked the LIBRE strategy that we're currently developing, which is from the European Research Libraries. Not because I want to promote the LIBRE strategy, or I want also to promote the LIBRE strategy because I'm on the executive board, but because I thought it's a nice way to show where is the current discussion. So maybe it's interesting for you because you have a slightly different perspective, different weighting of topics and themes, but I think this depicts quite well where is the current discussion and where do you think the world is going in from a European perspective in the next year. So forget the research libraries, just look at the themes that are mentioned here. So forget the research libraries, it's not the main point that I want to make. But it's a very simple strategy that's saying we're focusing on three points. We want to build platforms for innovative scholarly communication, hubs for digital skills and services. A big topic at the moment in Europe, particularly also because digitalization is bringing the situation that economy and industry needs a lot of people with digital skills. So this is a big thing at the moment. And then build a research infrastructure. And you see that there are five areas around that, objectives basically. And I think it's a good summary of where you could be in 2022. So it says open access is the predominant form of publishing. Research data is findable, accessible, interoperable, and fair. Digital skills underpin a more transparent research lifecycle, and research infrastructure is a participatory, tailored and scaled to the needs of the diverse disciplines. And then there is tomorrow's cultural heritage is built on today's digital information, because there is also this task that we have to provide sustainable services. So I thought it's a good entry point to what is going on, what is the general discussion, probably not so surprising to you, but it gives a good overview. Then at the European level, there are some things that I wanted to mention. It's a little political, but it's important also to see what is on the horizon. The European Commission already has a draft open science agenda. And I think it's already being implemented at the moment through several instruments that are being applied. And you can just Google this document, the draft open science agenda. You will see that it's quite detailed. So this is just a screenshot of the start of the document. And there are several initiatives that are going on at the moment. That are noteworthy, that are trying to implement open science in, well, people are waiting outside, not to disturb anything, but I think they can come inside. So trying to implement this open science policy, one of them is the European Cloud Initiative, which is trying to unlock the power of big data for open science. And it has two components. One is a very hidden one, but it's actually the most expensive one. It's the European data infrastructure. So there will be huge investments in data infrastructure in Europe. At least this is the plan, or this is the announcements. and it's hidden. There's not much information on it, because it's basically a big procurement process. Then the one that is mostly discussed is the European Open Science Cloud, which is actually small, but discussed. The Open Science Cloud is an idea that all infrastructure, all e-infrastructure being built in Europe in the future is going in a certain service portfolio. So it is actually not the idea to build something from scratch and new, but all the existing infrastructure, e-infrastructure, digital infrastructure developments that are happening in Europe, and there are many, they should go through a kind of quality assurance process with meeting the criteria that are being characterized at the moment, gets integrated into the European Open Science Cloud. So Europe has a certain service portfolio for e-infrastructure that is reliable and that can be used in all projects. That's the basic, very simple idea that's early on, but it's an example of how the European Commission is currently trying to implement open science policy. So you see, I just wanted to mention that there is a strong move from open access to open science being a more comprehensive, holistic view of the research process. It's the simple formula, open access to publications plus open access to research data equals open science. I don't believe in that formula, but I think this is the kind of thinking that is going on in the background. And I think think that the repositories will have to adapt. I think we're doing that in Europe, that we're not only looking at the publication, but we still have to do our homework in that area, but we're trying to expand carefully to the data at Open Science. Thank you.